The Dana Show.
American jurisprudence is under attack. It's under attack. Every word is losing meaning. We have a legal system now that doesn't even want to identify or define what a woman is. If you can't take the time to learn about the issue that you want to regulate or ban or whatever, then why should the rest of us take any time at all to take you seriously or to give your opinion air?
The Dana Show.
No, we shouldn't. And here's the way that we'll do it. There's two completely different worldviews on this. You know, the Biden budget came out. It would make the largest tax increases in U.S. history, about $4.9 trillion in tax increases. It would raise the debt to about $52 trillion over the next 10 years. We can't go down that road. We're going to crash the U.S. economy. We all recognize that. So what we present is the alternative view, and that is our House Budget Committee passed their resolution here in the last couple of weeks, and it would balance the federal budget in 10 years and cut $15 trillion in spending while not affecting Social Security or Medicare. This is possible to do, but it takes very tough political choices, and you got to limit the size and scope of the federal government. What a concept. We've been talking about that for a long time. There is a path to do it.
So that's Speaker Mike Johnson, because the bill that has been pushed through, well, that's going to probably be pushed through, let's be honest about it, is just, it's absolute trash garbage. It's big spending, and that's the problem. It's still continuous big spending. We're going to break some of that down here for you today. First off, welcome to the program. Dana Lash with you, top of this first hour on Thursday. It's just a crazy, busy, overwhelming day. All right, so the second half of the whole omnibus, you know, if you wanted to, the second half of the omnibus is ultimately what is, this is the thing that's coming down, this is the thing that's down the pike. I mean, the budget with this, it's just bad policy. It's just bad spending. We're going to go through some of it. And there's been a lot of, there's been a lot of consternation about it online. We're going to go over, you know, what it actually includes. They said it's almost maybe $20 billion for the border, but you have $495 million they were saying for additional, I guess, personnel. But what does that mean when you're talking about increasing border security? That's what they were saying the last time that they were pushing this, except the problem was is that it was just for people to help process those who were coming in illegally. It was just to help kind of process all of that through and not really anything about enforcement, etc. Now, the deportation aspect of it, this is the big thing that, you know, the states are fighting with the federal government about. And the act of deportation is still something that the federal government argues is within its purview. But it's very difficult to argue for the federal government that it's within its purview, considering the fact that, well, they just haven't been doing it. They just won't actually do what needs to be done and won't make that a part, that messaging a part of their enforcement. So, like I said, we're going to go through all of this. There's just a lot to hit because you've got this. This is six spending bills that have been pushed together in one giant omnibus. And, of course, it's over 1,000 pages. They dropped it last night. And they're expected to make, like, the initial votes on it today, which is, I mean, how are you reading over 1,000 pages of legalese and spending? And you know that's what a lot of this is. It's legalese and spending. How are you going to read 1,000 pages of that? I mean, it's rhetorical. You're not. They're not. They're not going to do it. It's just about getting it through and getting it done. So I tell you, this is exactly how you mess up in an election season. It's exactly how you mess up in an election season. The other thing, too, that we're waiting for is some of the latest moves on SB4 that has to do with the immigration, well, the border bill, the border enforcement in Texas. SB4, as we've discussed, that includes the arrest and the detention of illegal entrants, but it doesn't include the deportation of illegal entrants because, again, that's something still the federal government. That's what they try to tie everybody's hands. That was the big fight that they were having with Jan Brewer in Arizona. You all remember this. And so the chaotic I guess that's the best way you could put it. There was some chaos yesterday for a handful of hours before a lower court then stayed it. So now, because the Supreme Court had said it could go ahead and go through, and this was after Alito had extended this injunction, and then there was a federal appeals court that blocked it. So now they said that they can't rule on it unless the Fifth Circuit rules on it. And so now they had a three-judge panel on the Fifth that issued an order that blocks it. And they didn't actually really explain, you know, much about their decision with it. So that's one of the other things that we're watching. So there's a lot of stuff that's kind of that's pushing around in D.C. We've got also the U.S. submitting a resolution. They're demanding an immediate ceasefire in Gaza. But of course, they try to add very quietly, you know, a caveat about releasing hostages, which Hamas is never going to do. They're never going to do because it's been worth it for them to not. As sickening as it is, it's been worth it for them to not. So we're gonna follow that. Also, the latest with the EV fight, and we've got a bunch of culture as well to get into. But this border, let's go back to this because this bill with $19.6 billion for border protection. So this is they say it's investment at the border. Well, unless it's boots on the ground, the problem is that they act like that's a win by itself. They act like apportioning, you know, a certain amount is, oh, well, that's it. You get everything that you want on the border. But they by doing this, they are sidestepping the main issue, which is enforcement, because what's the point of spending all of this money with stuff at the border, particularly when you're fighting with lawmakers as to whether or not or elected officials in Texas, including law enforcement, you're fighting with them as to whether or not they can arrest or detain people. If you're pushing back on whether or not they can arrest or detain and you're barring them from deporting, what the hell exactly are you spending money on if it's not for processing and, you know, getting people through faster and then releasing them in the interior? And that's the big question. So they act like it's a huge win for Republicans. Oh, we're giving you this. Look, we're going to give you some money for this. And then Republicans act like they're all big for asking for it, but it ignores the giant question. What about deportations? What about arresting and detainment? Because this is what SB4 is all about. So what exactly, if you're spending, because this is a major $1.2 trillion package, if you're spending this type of money, then what is it that you're spending, what, $19.6 billion for customs and border protection? And they're bragging it's a $3.2 billion increase above fiscal year 23. And we're going to have $495 million for additional Border Patrol agents. And the Biden administration, hey, look, the Biden administration called for, we're going to have 22,000 additional border agents. Okay, but what about any kind of a force multiplier, like a literal physical barrier that we call a wall? Nope, you don't get that. You're not getting that funding. You're not getting that funding. Additionally, to my point, immigration detention beds, they're boosting from 34 to 42,000. So they're adding $10,000 additional detention beds at all of these processing facilities that many of these NGOs run. So this goes right to the point that my whole original point is that this is about processing people quicker, releasing them to the interior. That's all what this is about. Now, in addition to this, I know, happy Thursday to you. You're so excited. Biden is, quote unquote, forgiving another $5.8 billion in student debt for nearly 78,000 borrowers. So this is out this morning. $6 billion in student loan relief, quote unquote. It applies to teachers, nurses, and firefighters, they said, who, due to previous failures with the system, didn't receive the earlier, quote unquote, forgiveness they were promised for going into public service. And it's this public service loan forgiveness program that they created in 07. And it was about forgiving student debt for people who enter jobs in public service. But most, which I think is, that's you're buying the public sector's vote, is what you're doing. You're buying the public sector's vote. You make it impossible to get affordable education. And then because of, I don't know how you want to put it, consumerism, societal practices, customs, culture, whatever it is, you know, you pay sports athletes more than you pay teachers because clearly the society spends money on what it values the most. And then you try to rectify this by forced spending through government. And that doesn't go out very well. And you still have education and teachers, people who, you know, they don't consider, they wouldn't voluntarily fund them as much as they would voluntarily go to a sports event. So they try to fix that again with more government and with more spending. And then they make these promises that they never are able to actually follow through on. You should just make, if you're, make college affordable and stop promoting within culture this idea that in order to have any kind of valuable, socially accepted profession, that you have to go to a four-year university. I mean, that would go a long way in starting to fix this, and then maybe not have DC run the whole thing. So this brings this total package under this president to $150 billion. And previously, I think it was only something like 7,000 received that quote-unquote public service loan forgiveness. It's not forgiveness, you're sure. But it's not just like public service workers. I mean, they've been forgiving debt from private circus. They've been forgiving a private sector. They've been forgiving, private circus actually applies. They've been forgiving debt from, it's a vote buying scheme. It is an absolute vote buying scheme. And then all of these articles, oh my goodness, higher education debt has just tripled. It's so mean. Student federal aid figures, it's so mean. Yeah, after the federal government under Barack Obama and with people like Elizabeth Warren in the Senate, they voted to consolidate total control of college loans in D.C. They put it under the purview of the federal government. And then you're shocked that it got run into a hole in the ground. You're shocked that education, the cost of it has tripled. You're shocked by all of this. You voted for the, some of these people who are complaining about this voted for the very people who actually made it what it is today. They said most people would receive widespread relief. Through that, they would receive between $10,000 and $20,000. So everybody else pays for the student loans. This is absolutely vote buying, and it's a redistribution of wealth because you're forcing people who did not take out such loans or people who already paid their loans, you're making them responsible for the debt that someone else voluntarily, of their own free will, chose to accrue. That is communist. That is anti-American, and it's lazy, and it's grifting, and it's academic welfare. This is academic welfare. You're creating another entitlement class with this idea that that academics is a form of nobility in this country. This is exactly what it is. Now, a few other things. This, as we're watching this, they're going to be fighting over this bill going through, the spending bill. I'm seeing some other stuff on it now. As more and more lawmakers are actually being able to read it since it was dropped last night, how nice. This U.S. resolution that's submitted by Anthony Blinken demanding a ceasefire linked to the release of hostages in Gaza. He submitted a draft U.N. resolution. This was to the Security Council, calling for an immediate ceasefire linked to the release of hostages. Now, remember, Hamas has said they have zero interest in releasing any type of hostages right now. So this just seems like a scream in the wind. We're going to talk more about this as well coming up as we move our partners at Hope. Metabolism for sustaining energy and weight management. Field of Greens is an organic superfood rich in antioxidants, fiber, and prebiotics formulated to enhance overall well-being. People taking Field of Greens have noticed more energy throughout the day, healthier looking skin, and improved digestion. You'll notice better health or your money back. If you resolve to get healthier in 24, it starts with Field of Greens. Visit fieldofgreens.com and use promo code Dana to get 15% off your first order and free rush shipping. That's promo code Dana at fieldofgreens.com.
And now, all of the news you would probably miss. It's time for Dana's Quick Five.
So, I have no idea why people think that they can keep an 11-foot gator in their home in New York, but they can, apparently. This home, it's caused some backlash. New York man and, his supporters are wanting to know what happened to the 11-foot, 750-pound gator that he had in his home. Now, if the gator's not bothering anybody, I mean, you know, if it's not eating anybody's pets, anything like that, the Department of Environmental Conservation officers showed up at this dude's home in Erie County, town of Hamburg, on Wednesday. They found that he had built an addition to his home just for the gator and built an in-ground swimming pool to keep the gator and keep it happy. He, like, allowed people, like kids even, to get in the water and pet Albert the alligator, and the gator wasn't secured. You can think that they're tame and they're domesticated, but, you know, that doesn't necessarily mean it's true. He said, I took care of him better than most people took care of their kids. He didn't have any incidents with him, but apparently they said he had to have licensing. I don't know, some other stupid New York stuff. This is baffling scientists at a German zoo. Chimps are ripping out each other's hair, and they're walking around all jacked, like all muscular and like shredded wheat. They're ripping out each other's hair in Germany, at the zoo in Germany. And they said it's alarming the visitors at Madsberg Zoo. There's a sign next to the enclosure saying that because of over-grooming, they look psychotic. They have bald spots everywhere. And they said some of them are almost entirely hairless. So is it over-grooming? I mean, it is weird. They say that where they're being kept is too small, according to some animal rights groups, and that's it's adding to their stress, and it's stressing them out, and that's maybe what it is. Or it's maybe they're animals and they do weird stuff. I don't know. The GOP, remember, the RNC was talking about hiring activist Scott Pressler. Now, apparently, they're not going to do it. At first, they said that they were, and I guess now that they're not. They said that they had a call with him, and it went very well, but apparently they're not going to be working with him. I think he did a better job than the RNC in getting out the vote, so we'll see what happens there. Daniel Penny appeared in a Manhattan court yesterday. Judge set the trial date of October 8th for the chokehold death of Jordan Neely. I have a piece up at Substack about this for you subscribers. And remember, the way that the media is writing about this story is absolutely asinine, and we're going to talk about that here coming up. A man was charged after 26 snakes were found in a vehicle. There was no word as to whether or not it was a car full of lawmakers in D.C. This actually happened, or even in Sydney. This happened in Australia. They said that 26 snakes were found in the man's vehicle. He was charged with animal cruelty. He's psychotic. Deadly morel mushrooms. People need to learn how to properly cook mushrooms, because undercooked mushrooms apparently killed two people and sickened more than 50 diners at a restaurant in Montana, according to a CDC investigation. They said that they were stumped that people were getting sick like this, and they realized that these undercooked mushrooms were likely to blame. They called it a deadly fungi outbreak in Montana. 51 people, gastrointestinal illness. Two were killed, so you got to properly cook these things. And the U.S. has backed a $50 billion bond for Ukraine using frozen Russian assets. Coming up, a woman banned from the pool because she spoke out. This is at YMCA, you know, Christian, Young Men's Christian Association. We'll talk about that. We got a whole bunch of other stuff on the way. Stick with us. Now, speaking of trans tyranny, you guys know Cherry Curry, right? And if you don't, why? The Runaways, one of my absolute favorite bands, because it was a girl rock band and they just pioneered girl rock. And there are a lot of women today that are in rock and roll, or people who like women in rock and roll, that owe a debt of gratitude to Cherry Curry. She was the singer, right? So she got canceled by trans tyrants at the ironically named Riot Girl Festival in Bisbee, Arizona. They canceled her because she spoke out against the grooming of kids and targeting of kids with trans surgeries. The Riot Girl Festival. That whole festival wouldn't exist without people like Cherry Curry. All of these remedial power chord playing bitches can only have a space in the musical sphere because Curry blazed the path for you. People like Suzy Quatro, people like Sherry Curry, people like Lita Ford. So bow down and give thanks. I just find that incredibly asinine. Yeah, she opposed the transitioning of minors. She's like, if you're an adult, and she's even like more to the left of a lot of conservatives on the issue. She's like, if you're an adult, you choose to do this with your own dollars. That's one thing. She's like, but if you're a child, how? And I agree with the reasoning that it's not informed consent. It isn't informed consent. You're pumping people full of hormones. That I'm going to tell you, I had an aunt, I don't want to give anybody's names, who, when she went through menopause, they did all the hormone stuff with her. She ended up developing a serious health issue because of that. They have no idea. There are no long-term studies on this stuff. You're just jacking kids up with hormones. To hell with the consequences they're going to have to deal with a decade down the road. Big Pharma's like, yeah. That's not informed consent. And so they're actually canceling her from the Riot Girl Festival. That's one of the funniest things I've ever heard of. Because that whole thing, if you know that term, like took off like early 90s, and that was it was like L7 and really, you know, hard, grungy, guitar-driven rock. I mean, there were like a bunch of bands that were there. But you have like a lot of these new chicks that are out, and I'm like, how are you canceling this icon? And some of the chicks that got big in the 90s, how are you canceling an icon like this? You either want to protect kids or you don't. She's saying, can we protect kids from this? This isn't informed consent. She's 1,000% correct. And I think it's incredibly brave for her to go out and say stuff like this, especially in this environment. There is nothing more metal or punk rock than what she just did. And she's not stepping down. She's not backing down off it either. She is an absolute icon. If you think you're going to sit here and make Sherry Curry back down from something, you're a moron. You have no concept of this lady's history. She's a chainsaw artist, for crying out loud. You think that she's got time for your stupid political sensitivities about grooming kids? Kane, who the hell are these people think they are?
I don't know.
The whole reason I ever picked up a guitar, I play rhythm guitar horribly, and I can play drums. The only reason I ever did was because people like Sherry Curry. I had a Runaways t-shirt that I still have. You don't believe me? Check my Twitter. True story. Golly. Instead of like complaining about her performing somewhere, I would be punching chicks in the neck to be first in line to get a ticket to be front row to see her. And she's absolutely 1,000% right. You know, pointing out that kids should be protected from this hormonal experimentation. And that's exactly what it is, because there are zero long-term studies. It is so dangerous. Kids that are still going through puberty that haven't even fully formed yet. Oh my gosh, this is so dangerous. That's not care and it's not informed consent. And she's right.
Looking for the drive-through version of The Dana Show? Check out the best highlights from every show and Dana's Absurd Truth podcast, posted daily from The Dana Show.
Mi gente, he pensado invadir una casa en United States. Ya que me enteré que existe una ley que dice que si una casa no está habitada, podemos expropiarla.
So this guy Capici, on TikTok, he's a muchachos, TikTok influencer. I hate these phrases. This is like a brave new world we're in. He is telling people who are coming into the country illegally, look, you can like literally take over somebody's house and invoke squatter's rights and make it impossible to be removed from these properties. His name is Lionel Moreno, and he's like apparently from Venezuela. And he was telling people that under U.S. law, if a house isn't inhabited, you can seize it. He's talking about squatters' rights, or what they call adverse possession law. And we talked about this yesterday, how this is like a big thing. We're seeing it over and over again. It's one of the wildest things where someone, particularly in these like, you know, very blue sanctuary city states where somebody can come in and take your house, seize your house, and you're kind of SOL. This one woman was arrested in New York because she changed the locks on her door. For instance, in New York, you can't even turn off the utilities. Like you, if someone took over the house, they don't have to pay you rent. I'm not exaggerating any of this, by the way. They don't have to pay you rent, but you have to pay their electric bill, their water bill. You're not allowed to change the locks. You're not allowed none of that. They have more rights than you do as the property owner, even though they went in and without your permission or any kind of agreement and took over the house. And these laws have gotten progressively worse over the years. And it's to the point now where it's, you know, it's one of the wildest things. And sadly, you know, all of these people that are dealing with us, there was one guy who basically said that he squatted them back, I think was the thing that he did. He squatted them back and went in and changed the locks and was like, no, it's my house now. So kind of, I mean, how, it's just the goofiest thing ever, but there's this rot, this attack on American jurisprudence. So this video was viewed 4 million times. People were saying that this guy's promoting terrorism, and they were calling the FBI and all this. They have squatter's rights in all 50 states, but some states are worse than others. I don't even know what the hell a squatter's right is. It's just, it is insane to me that it's even a thing. It's insane that it is a phrase. Like, if you're in the process of selling your house, say you're in one of these states that has, you know, pretty leftist interpretation of this, and you're trying to sell your house, and say you've moved out, but you're still on the market, they can move in, and you are SOL. Not only do you still have to pay for that mortgage, but you also have to pay for all of the utilities, because they can give you an additional, they can charge you with something extra if you turn the utilities off. And you have to pay for these people to live in your property, and you have no rights over it at all. You have to go to court. It's incredibly expensive. You incur all of the costs that go along with that legal challenge. It's wild. It is wild. And it's happening everywhere. Washington, California, New York. I mean, it's happening everywhere. I mean, in New York, they get 30 days. And so the way that they do this, it could be your house and you didn't agree to rent it. Say you're not even renting it at all. But if they go in and move into your house and they're there for, you know, they can somehow say that they're there for 30 days, then you're considered a landlord. And then you have to start the eviction proceedings, and it's all the legal stuff that goes with it. And in all states, you have to follow a legal eviction process to remove squatters. Now, my legal eviction process is made with lead, and it comes out of the barrel of a rifle. That is my eviction process. So, I mean, breaking and entering, people can get charged with breaking and entering, but if you stay there, then that changes it. That's just the dumbest thing I've ever seen. This is how you're going to get vigilantism. You are going to get vigilantism, and you're going to get people who are going to take it upon themselves because they can't afford the legal costs that that comes with pushing people out who break and enter and stay in these homes illegally. But in these blue states, these sanctuary cities and sanctuary states, I mean, I'm just saying, it seems like you know, you get what you vote for, right? You have to live with what you vote for. New York City, though, they have like the most progressive laws on the book. There was one guy who moved in somebody else's basement of their house and he wouldn't leave. There was another lady who was in New York who was arrested because she moved in Or no, she had tried to kick out the squatters, and she ended up getting there. And then there's the woman from Queens that we talked about yesterday, Adele Indoloro, can you imagine right after your parents pass and you're having to deal with getting rid of their property and getting rid of like the house, and then you have to deal with the squatter issue because a squatter moves in after your parents pass away. Can you imagine having to deal with that? So this woman is just being victimized and re-victimized and re-victimized. It's insane. And she's fighting. They said that witnesses to this particular house in Flushing's, they were doing construction on the house. Not only were the squatters living there, but they were doing construction on the house that's not even theirs. It's insane. And so there you go. And these people have no proof at all whatsoever that there was any kind of, you know, there was no agreement. And they're not offered. They're not offered they don't even offer to pay for anything. There was a guy, this was in California. It was a $4.5 million mansion. Crazy. $4.5 million mansion. And squatters moved in. And it's crazy. They said that in Los Angeles and Atlanta, some squatters have been turning homes into strip clubs and hosting all night raves. I'm telling you. And it's in every state, but like I said, some states it's, you know, more so than others. And even in Texas, you have to go through an eviction process in Texas to lawfully remove a squatter. If someone takes over your home, I consider that to be a home invasion. And I would love for someone to examine, you know, Castle Doctrine and then going and moving into, I mean, that's trespass. The idea that a law ceases to have effect because of how long someone is breaking it is one of the dumbest things to happen in the American legal system I've ever seen. They say, oh, well, squatters, you know, they can stay for a while. You know, trespassing is short term, squatters long term. So the period of time that they are illegally present in someone else's property without permission determines the legality of their situation. That's absolutely crazy. But it's adverse possession law. And so they say, but adverse possession law, the way that works is it's supposed to be an honestly entered property. Or a property that is held in the possession with the belief that the land is theirs, or that the property is theirs. That's what this is. But the fact that this is even in Texas is bad. Like in Texas, if you feel that you or your property are under threat, Castle Doctrine comes into play. But what if someone's been there? What if you're on vacation and you come back, you know, after, you know, however many days, and you have somebody in your home and my gosh, you feel threatened, your property's threatened. So at what point does Castle Doctrine then go away? Doesn't have any effect because they're now doing this adverse possession. This is the goofiest thing I've ever seen. And it's so, none of it's consistent. In state after state, there's zero consistency. So, for instance, in Tennessee, guests are considered tenants after paying rent as specified in a lease. In Texas, guests are considered tenants if they contribute to expenses or use the mailing address. That's crazy. So there's no consistency across the country. There's zero consistency. But yeah, squatters' rights. Can't even imagine. It's just wild. Now, to this point, because this individual coming in illegally from Venezuela, did you hear the story about how this administration, nearly 200,000 illegal entry cases, deportation cases, were thrown out because the Biden administration didn't file the paperwork before the court hearings? It's a new report from the Transactional Records Access Clearinghouse, and they analyzed the number of deportation cases that were thrown out, particularly under Biden's tenure. They said that the number of cases and dismissals and lack of transparency is, quote, troubling, but that they had failed to file the required notice to appear, before court dates in 200,000 cases. So in 200,000 of these cases, they were thrown out. Remember, they kept saying that they needed to hire more people so that they could process people. So this is how they're trying to force your hand into supporting some of this stuff. They're trying to force your hand into supporting it by saying that, well, you know, look what happens. These cases get, they just get thrown out. That's what happens. These cases are thrown out and, you know, this is all you're left with. That's insane. This is crazy. But this is what we're dealing with right now. And there wasn't any, apparently they didn't tell anybody that they were doing this. They didn't tell anybody that this was happening. So now the courts don't have the jurisdiction to handle, they don't have the jurisdiction to handle these cases and rule on even any asylum claims. And all these people are just, you know, just in the interior. The ones that, the very few that actually do return to court. But now this is a Department of Homeland Security issue as well. I mean, this is wild, just wild. But the one of the reasons that the open borders people are upset about this is because they say, well, it makes it more difficult for them to secure, for people who enter illegally, free shelter and other taxpayer-funded items, like getting your free cell phone and getting all this other stuff. Like when that notice to appear isn't filed, apparently that makes it to where they can't get these freebies. So it's kind of a, but then they just are released through the interior. So it's a catch-22. You see what I'm saying? It's a catch-22. It is lawlessness, an absolute, we just have just lawlessness in this country. It's sad. We have more on the way. We've got Florida Man coming up. This is what else we have on deck, too. No, Florida Man's coming up next hour. We have Days of These United States. There's new polling that's been released about, it was done by Gazan residents, and they polled Gazan residents. And guess how popular Hamas still is in Gaza? And the percentage of people who thought that Gaza's actions on October 7th were just and defensible, and they still support them. It's exactly as I told you. It's unbelievable. We're going to talk about that. The Olympics is denying athletes air conditioning because of quote-unquote climate change. And there's an update in the story of the Missouri teenager who had her head bashed into pavement. The attacker, the family of the attacker, is insisting that she is the real victim, and she's an honor roll student, which means that you can just bash people's heads against the concrete in an attempted murder, and that's supposed to be allowable because you got good grades one semester. We'll talk about all of that and more as we roll.
Don't let FOMO get the best of you. Stay in the loop and ahead of the curve by following Dana on Apple, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts.
Like sands through the hourglass, so are the days of the United States.
Is it your testimony today that you personally witnessed President Joe Biden commit a crime?
I believe the fact that he was sitting with me while I was putting together a
business deal. Did you witness the president commit a crime? Is it your testimony today?
Yes.
And what crime have you witnessed?
How much time do I have to go through it?
It is simple. You name the crime. Did you watch him steal something?
Corruption statutes, RICO, and conspiracy.
What is it? What is the crime, sir?
You
specifically.
You ask me to answer the question. I answered the question.
No.
RICO, you're obviously not familiar with. Corruption
Excuse
statute.
Excuse me, sir. Excuse Aura. Me, sir. Excuse me, sir. RICO is not a crime. It is a category. What is
the category of crimes that you're then charged?
She's been fighting with Ted Cruz about this, which is really going to, I think, go well for her, because RICO is most absolutely, and I said this yesterday, it's a crime. RICO is a crime. I mean, that's why you have tons. I mean, who was it that was just committed a? Just convicted of a RICO charge. I mean, we actually had this as a headline of maybe a couple of months ago. The idea that it's not just, oh, well, you have to have X amount of crimes and then that makes up RICO. That's not how this law works. She should stick to slinging drinks and leave the legal issues to people who actually have reading comprehension. That's one of the stupidest things I've ever heard in my life. The idea that it's not a... okay. What? It's a crime. I mean, it's goofy. This is so goofy. I mean, it's part of the U.S. criminal code. And she just, this is all to defend the Bidens. This is all to defend Hunter Biden. It's all to defend Joe Biden. Anything, it's a law if it's applicable to everybody else. But if it has to do with Democrats, then no. It's not a law. It's not a law then if it has to do with Democrats. Can't make it a law. We're going to unlaw it. It's not a law at that point. It's just bizarre. Just absolutely bizarre. I mean, she's been arguing, like I said, she's been arguing with Ted Cruz today. I mean, I don't know. Maybe if you explained it to her like you would the make of a drink, then maybe she would get it. I don't know. I mean, and she kept saying, well, you can't name an illegal act that he did. Really? The illegal act is the very thing, the numerous illegal acts that would constitute a RICO violation are all of the stuff that he was doing in violating tax code. That's just like part of it. Furthermore, the failure to disclose business ties with China. I mean, yeah, if you want to get into all the entire list of all of the stuff that he's done, I mean, what the hell are you sitting in the hearing for? She's heard this stuff come out. They've heard them literally. That is why the banks began investigating. That is why the FBI got involved. Now, they are investigating whether or not these violations are, because they're still getting evidence. This is, again, it's all about finding evidence. It's an inquiry. Democrats, it's a foreign concept to them because they didn't do this when they were investigating Trump. They didn't have an investigation of Trump. They literally just said, I don't like him. We're going to impeach. That is the whole of the impeachment. Never was a criminal charge brought, ever. So that's why this is such a foreign concept to them. We have a lot more to get into. Second hour on the way. You don't want to miss a lot more of The Dana Show coming up. A lot of stuff to discuss, a lot of stuff to hit, a lot of rage.
Y'all ever wondered what a 500-foot roll of inch and a quarter pecs looks like?
Where them cicadas.
And if you want to know how fun it is to unroll this mess, not very. Especially when it's, 100 freaking degrees out here in South Alabama. But At least the heat will help it straighten out. Appreciate y'all.
So I don't even know. I don't even know who this chick is. Her name is Hannah. And she's Hannah Baron. She's, you know, on TikTok. And she's helping to build a house. Her house. Her own house. On TikTok. She doesn't have a Twitter account. And, you know, she's just, you know, she's a hard worker. She's pretty. She's, you know, she's young. She has a shirt that has a rifle on it in one of the videos. So I know she sports 2A. And for some reason, some of these, like, fake, they call themselves, like, trad right. I think that they're fake accounts that are manufactured. It's a psyop to divide the right. I really do believe this. And then one of the things that went viral was some chick from Lebanon who apparently cosplays as an American conservative. I don't know. And I'm not going to make her famous. But she went off on this Hannah chick and American women. She said, quote, this accent needs to be illegal and women should be banned from doing manual labor like this. There is nothing feminine about American women. American women are literally men. So I took a look at this lady's Twitter account, the lady who was criticizing Hannah. And she's one of those who, like, her eyebrows are gradients, you know. She does the contouring and she wears so much makeup. She looks kind of like a lunchtime drag queen. And I had said on Twitter, I wrote, I'm not listening to engagement criticism about Southern women's accents from any female who wears enough pancake makeup to run her own printing press with just her face and a stack of clean pillowcases. Which is true. If I have to do a neck check on you, girl, then you don't need to be talking about anybody else's femininity. There is too much. My grandmother always said, and I know that this is a statement, a quote that she didn't make up, but she just repeated it. Makeup should be a secret between a woman and her mirror. She shouldn't be an entire palette from Sephora. She didn't add the Sephora part. I did. I mean, we should not know that you did a gradient on your eyebrows, right? You should not be wearing so much rouge on your cheeks that I can probably do like a sample of it, take it to Sephora and they could paint match it like they could at Home Depot. Shouldn't have to do that. And for anyone who has never heard Southern women speak, especially if you're from Southern Alabama, that's how Southern Alabama people speak. And there's nothing wrong with it. I mean, I'm sorry that you don't look like you have enough arm muscles to, like, even butter toast. But, you know, that doesn't mean that a woman who can help build her own house is somehow unfeminine. I want to know who these jackwagons are that they think that they have the patent on defining who is or who is not feminine. Because I will tell you one thing that I see all these other engagement clout chasers who are running down this Hannah Baron. One thing that they lack that she doesn't, and it is a very important qualification for ladies and femininity, and that is class. I found that absolutely fascinating, that whole thing. And I just, it amazes me that that became like a huge debate over the weekend, end of last week and this weekend. And why are we taking, I'm sorry, a foreigner? A foreign woman's I don't even think is a citizen, probably can't even vote here. Your opinion on American women? Let's see. I don't have to ask my husband for permission to own a firearm. I don't have to cover up the beauty that God created on me. I don't have to do any of that stuff. So I think maybe, you know, do a self-check along with a neck check.
The Dana Show.
American jurisprudence is under attack. It's under attack. Every word is losing meaning. We have a legal system now that doesn't even want to identify or define what a woman is. If you can't take the time to learn about the issue that you want to regulate or ban or whatever, then why should the rest of us take any time at all to take you seriously or to give your opinion air?
The Dana Show.
They tell me they are not a monolith, and it's really difficult to just use one ad campaign to reach out to everybody because there are so many varying opinions and priorities within the Latino community. The one thing they agreed on, though, is that in their culture, they say they don't like it when people beat around the bush. They want people to get to the point, and they're tired of hearing Biden's rhetoric and flowery language. They want to hear more details. They want to hear a specific platform about what he plans to do.
Yeah, they don't like it when you just, I mean, nobody does, but especially, I mean, I think that certain communities have less patience for BS than others, less tolerance for it than others. Nobody likes feeling like they're being taken on a ride, especially when you are doing outreach to a specific community or a specific demographic, and the appearance and strategy of messaging is that, oh, well, I'm just telling you the truth. I'm just being straight, no chaser with you. I'm just playing it down the middle. I'm just telling you how it is. And you're not. Because you look like a liar. Welcome back to the show. Top of the second hour. Dana Lash with you. You can listen coast to coast, channel 347 DirecTV. You can find us on X as well. We're streaming there, YouTube, Facebook, Substack, the newsletter, chapter and verse. And this is going to be an issue for Democrats. They just don't know how to get over this barrier that they have been operating under as it pertains to outreach. And you thought Republicans had an outreach problem, which they do. Both groups really do, if I'm being honest about it. Democrats, though, here's the problem with each. Republicans don't actually do outreach in certain, they're getting better at it. But their outreach historically, especially to different minority communities, has been heinous because they just don't do it. They just don't go out there to do it. When I lived in Missouri, I lived in St. Louis, and there was the first congressional district that was historically Democrat. It is majority Black voters, although I think that that's you have a lot of Hispanic voters, et cetera, that have come in now in the past like 20 years. But it's a minority district, really. And Republicans just never really spent a lot of time trying to do voter outreach because they always, and this is how they tell it to the people who donate and the big money backers, you know, they want to be able to show a return on the investment of donations and financing. And that return is votes. That return is control in the area. And it's the way that Republicans have always measured, I think, a successful outreach campaign, because it doesn't necessarily mean that's going to translate into a vote proper, like maybe this election, but maybe in a future election, it will. I mean, a lot of times the victory is just planting the seed, and Republicans did not put, they would just assume this district's gone. And I understand it when you're working with a limited budget, you're trying to maximize your dollars. That's what you do with your household. That's what you do with anything else. You try to maximize where can I get the most bang for my buck. But at the same time, you have to measure it a little bit differently where it concerns political outreach. So that's always been kind of the problem with Republicans and outreach to minority voters. And then Democrats, I think that now a lot of people are really waking up and saying, you know, how long have you promised us stuff? You said that the economy was going to get better and you made it worse. You said that there were going to be more jobs and there aren't jobs. You've done all this and it's all been made demonstrably worse. So, you know, where's the return on this investment of our support? And they don't know how to explain that. They don't have the product. Republicans have the product. Their messaging sucks. Democrats don't have the product. They used to just BS you with messaging. Now they can't even do that anymore because the product is so bad. They can't even fluff it up with over the top, you know, language anymore to try to sell people on something that they don't have. They can't even do that anymore. They're bad salespeople now, which is kind of wild to see. But I think that's because things have gotten so bad and they've been just so irresponsible that it's, you know, kind of to be expected. I mean, are you really shocked by this? You're not going to be able to shine this up. It's not going to happen. That's why I think this is going to be just disastrous, too. Further, looking at the spending that they're wanting to do. Good heavens, that's going to make everything worse. The idea isn't to say we realize, you know, the bad situation with the economy, but we're going to try to offset that with more bad policy to create an even worse economy. Audio soundbite two, Biden's he's begging them at this point. He's begging Latino voters. Listen to this.
Election is not a referendum on me. It's an election between me and a guy named Trump. And this is a guy who who's the way he talks about the Latino community is, in 2016, he called Latinos criminal, drug dealers, and rapists when he came down that escalator. Now he says immigrants are poisoning the blood of our country. You're the reason why, in large part, I beat Donald Trump. I need you. I need you badly.
That's not what Trump said, though. Trump was talking about people coming in across the border illegally, and it wasn't just Latinos. He was talking about people coming in from everywhere, including even Europe, including Middle Eastern nations, including, you know, everybody, China, and talking about how the basis of criminality would lead to more criminality if you're going to violate the law and enter illegally and try to sneak past Border Patrol. Chances are you're probably going to continue to commit crime. I mean, that's just a statistical reality. And the way that Democrats put it, oh, no, he's talking about all Latinos and Hispanics. That's what he, think about that, though. Think about that effort for a moment. They are trying to tell Latino voters that, well, you know, this is what Trump said. This is what this Republican Party leader said about Latino immigrants coming in, you know, across the border, people coming in, because it makes it sound like he was saying that about perfectly legal entry. And they omit the part where there were a lot of other nationalities thrown in, talking about, again, the first act of entering the country is to commit a crime by entering illegally. But the strategy of them telling Latino voters, well, this is what he said about you, lying to them about what Trump, lying to them and saying that here you're being called all of these things. Do you realize how, in and of itself, how racist that is? Biden is saying something that he wants these voters to believe that wasn't actually said. He's making a racist statement that wasn't said, but he's making the racist statement to get a payoff from it in the form of either anger at Republicans or support for him because, you know, he's not the racist. He's just going to make a racist statement and attribute it to somebody else. Do you see how insane that is? I don't think that that's working as well as it used to with Democrats. I don't think that it's having the effect that it's having with them. He also said this. I wanted to play audio soundbite one really quickly. He was talking about because he came into Texas yesterday, and I think he's got another fundraiser today. He was in Nevada and then Arizona and then came through Dallas. Listen to what he said about you.
Wages are up more than prices. Inflation is down dramatically. We have more to do. I get it. We have more to do. But no question, our plan of delivering for the American people is working now.
Wages are not up. I know that Democrats keep trying to push this, but the Economic Policy Institute was showing wage stagnation. The Public Policy Institute of California was saying that wage growth has been struggling to keep up with inflation. They keep trying to say, well, it's, you know, it's wages are maybe finally outpacing. It's not, though. They're trying to sell you something. You know what's happening with your bank account. You know how far your dollars can go. It's all about the economy, but you're not going to be able to lie to people about it for long. You're just not. Some of the other stuff I wanted to make sure that we hit today. This was this Daniel Penny case. Because I have some of this with some Law and Order stuff that I wanted to make sure that I get into. Because this is, again, and I'm going to get into the latest with the Missouri case as well. But this case with Daniel Penny, as you know, he got a trial date. I'm pulling up there's a piece that I have up on Substack if you get the newsletter I sent that to you because I was aggravated at what ABC, how ABC presented this. So his trial is going to be this fall, right? And it says, it gets in there, says Daniel Penny, the former Marine who choked a homeless man to death last May on a New York subway car, is going to stand trial beginning October 8th. Now, that's ABC's characterization of Daniel Penny's upcoming trial. And I've written about this case frequently. They don't even mention Jordan Neely. They make sure to mention Daniel Penny, though. Oh, he choked a man to death. He choked this innocent man to death. And he was charged for doing so, right? I mean, we talked about this right when this came out. Here's the issue. So Daniel Penny defended himself and other subway passengers against Jordan Neely, who is a violent offender, and he was lunging and threatening other passengers. And there are numerous witness accounts that are evidence of this. And in fact, they've talked to the press. The New York Post, the New York Times, both had interviews, both had sound bites from witnesses who said they actually thought they were going to die because Jordan Neely was threatening to kill them. He had a warrant out for his arrest, Jordan Neely did, related to his previous attack of an elderly woman in which he bashed her in the face, broke her nose, broke her orbital bone, and a bunch of other stuff. And he was trying, one report said he was trying to shove people onto the subway tracks. He was so violent and dangerous that there was a subreddit, literally a subreddit, meaning when you go on Reddit, there was a whole thread that was warning subway passengers about Jordan Neely and how violent he was. He hadn't dressed up as Michael Jackson for a decade. The press was like, oh, he's Michael Jackson impersonator. He's just this innocent guy. He hadn't dressed up as Michael Jackson for a decade. But apparently the legacy press thinks that some violence is okay, right? The media clearly thinks that Jordan Neely's life choices, which led to his situation and the warrant, somehow justify his violence against other people. Because if you're an innocent person, you're supposed to allow yourself to be murdered or attacked or raped or whatever so that you can make up for the media's perception of the criminal's disadvantageous position. That's what this is. The way that they talk about Jordan Neely, they act like, oh, he went through hard stuff in his life. Oh, he's poor. That's like one of the most sickening aspects of this story. It's this bigoted class warfare that the media promotes about people who go through hard times, right? Like, oh, be it a financial issue, be it a personal issue. It's this whole idea of, well, of course, you know, people like Jordan Neely commit crimes. I mean, that's to be expected. So you have to allow for it. That whole mentality is so bigoted. I had a story where I talked about how in St. Louis, there was in broad daylight, somebody was shot somebody else in broad daylight on camera, and the Soros-backed prosecutors dropped the charges. This is a tacit endorsement of violence by people in the media. And many on the left, when they have no, they apparently think that innocents should have no recourse when it comes to being attacked, when it comes to defense. Heaven forbid you might hurt the criminal. Apparently, the criminal's life is more valuable than the life of the innocent, so just take the attack. That is the bigoted class warfare that the media is promoting by way of how they position and present this story. That's just one of many examples. We have headlines on the way as we roll towards the bottom of the second hour. And as we do so, committing to a healthier diet this year seemed like a straightforward resolution, but actually doing it, that's way more challenging. Better nutrition is a key to health and longevity. So this year, get into a new healthy habit with Field of Greens. Field of Greens is nutrition the way nature intended it. Each superfruit and vegetable in Field of Greens was doctor selected to support vital organs such as the heart, lungs, and kidneys, as well as promoting a healthy metabolism for sustaining energy and weight management. Field of Greens is an organic superfood rich in antioxidants, fiber, and prebiotics formulated to enhance overall well-being. People taking Field of Greens have noticed more energy throughout the day, healthier looking skin, and improved digestion. You'll notice better health or your money back. If you resolve to get healthier in 24, it starts with Field of Greens. Visit fieldofgreens.com and use promo code Dana to get 15% off your first order and free rush shipping. That's promo code Dana at fieldofgreens.com.
And now, all of the news you would probably miss. It's time for Dana's Quick Five.
So apparently there's a terrifying threat of underpopulation as it's revealed how 75% of nations are facing baby busts by 2050, and the West will be left reliant on what they say are immigrants, triggering staggering social change. I feel like this is something that the left pushes while they accuse the right of doing this. I mean, this isn't, it's worldwide, the idea of population overload has always been a myth, and it's really, I mean, pretty much like that in every single country. There's maybe several that are keeping up with their birth rates, but there's no country that's like outpacing its birth rate. But they say that 3 in 4 countries face this threat of underpopulation by 2050. And they say that, you know, Britain and the United States, et cetera. And I just, you don't know, I just got like questions because of the way that this is being presented and the way it's pushed. Like they always talk about, the left always accuses people on the right of talking about whatever the great replacement theory, but yet when you hear them talk about the economy and, well, we need people to come in across the border, whether it's legally or illegally, like Jerry Nadler talking about the jobs that they need people to do, is that not what they're talking about? Like, how is that any different from what they're accusing? It's bizarre. I don't know. This is, I'm finally happy to see this actually take place. This has to do with our water supply. The Washington Examiner reported that the EPA has created a task force to finally like bolster U.S. water systems that could be vulnerable to cyber attacks, because apparently some cyber attacks have already hit some U.S. water systems. Countries like China and Iran, they say it's crucial that state governments improve their cyber defenses, and that this new initiative is expected to identify the most serious weaknesses in the country's water security. Even minor adjustments and updates, they say, can help limit or prevent these attacks. Additionally, this applications are open for Antarctica's penguin office, an office of penguins. This is apparently an actual thing. The penguin office in Antarctica is hiring British residents, UK residents, and a charity manager really wants to go. They were talking about how this follow this woman's bid to try to get this position. It's the Antarctic Heritage Trust. And every year they have 3 positions on offer. They're only open to UK residents. And apparently one of them is a penguin post office. And they said that you have to be self-motivated, empathetic, and you really only get to shower every couple of weeks. And that's pretty much it. So that's you know, if you're interested in all that. And of course, being in Antarctica, yeah, that's him. And now Donald Trump may not pay bond. They may have to, now there, some Democrats are saying they could seize Trump Towers to pay off that $435 million that Letitia James had set. Stay with us. We got a lot more in store. James Biden walked into Congress, or walked into the Capitol. He was speaking with lawmakers, and this is ongoing. He's, you know, the presidential. He's the presidential fixer. I feel like they try to make him the fixer. Who do you think is the Fredo between Joe and Jim?
The Fredo?
Yeah. It's always a Fredo.
It'd have to be Jim.
Yeah, it'd have to be Jim. They were trying to set up Beau and Hunter like this, like Jim and Joe. They were trying to set up Beau and Hunter like this. So James Biden, there's this whole story with him. So he goes in, he's the president's, you know, he's the president's deal, like he, you know, fixer. He handles the president's business. And now he's implicated in all of this stuff. And I was reading back by his history. This guy is so shady. So this is after that FBI informant story came out, and they're trying to say that the FBI informant isn't a legitimate guy. And so as a result, this whole thing's a sham. That's the way that they're trying to go about this. I think it's all a joke. I think that their accusations are stupid because this guy's a longtime informant. And apparently they've been really happy with his work this entire time. But they had this, first they have the closed door interview, and then they do the open hearing. So that's what they always do to make sure. I mean, that's, good heavens, that's how it always happens. And so they're questioning his brother. His brother, how do you go? And I was looking at this. How do you go from being like this shady dude who opens up clubs like Boots and Pants, right? And then you're like working with Chinese businesses. unless you're the Yakuza, you know. How are you this guy? He is as sketchy and shady as the day is long. Did you know that about him? He's like a club guy. He's a nightclub owner. He ran a nightclub. And then he goes from that to being the de facto presidential consort, sort of, to China and working with China. Tell me that that's not shady. Come on. This guy, the whole family is sketchy as all get out. I was reading this piece that was over at the Washington Post from the other day discussing how he was using his last name. He was tied to this like hospital chain and all this other stuff. And he really used his name to try to make as much money for himself and the family as possible. He Politico had this piece. When was this? This was a couple days ago where they talked about this rural healthcare empire that was being built by this Philly area consultant, and Jim Biden, who has got high, somehow he gets hired. The nightclub owner gets hired as the consultant. This is like an episode out of Ozark, right? And I can say that because, you know, come by it honest. You hire a nightclub owner to basically help consult on your rural healthcare empire. Make this make sense for me. This is the level of grift we're dealing with here. And this dude, Jim Biden, had no idea what the hell he was doing. He had no experience running nightclubs. Juan's got his picture up. Look at him. Doesn't he look like a great value version of Joe? Right? He looks like Joe, but his face is squeezed together. He had no experience running hospitals. None at all. But Politico noted, well, he did have ties to labor unions. And his last name is Biden. Huh. Now, they started doing this when Joe Biden was still vice president. Please don't exaggerate my own words. I almost feel bad for Barack Obama because he didn't just have Joe Biden. He had to bring, again, the whole family. He had Jim up in his business, too. He had Jim up there. He had Hunter. He had all of the Bidens. All of them. The ladies listening to the show will appreciate this comparison. It's like when they had the Bingleys welcomed all of the Bennets to their house for the first time in Pride and Prejudice. And it was literally Bennet after Bennet after Bennet after Bennet after Bennet. Same thing. Every Biden there. And remember, they had nieces and nephews that were working also in government, that they were getting nieces and nephews jobs. So it's not just the brother, and it's not just like the brother's wife, and it's not just, you know, Joe's sons. It's all their kids too. So keep that in mind. All of that was happening this period.
Elevate your commute, workouts, or downtime with the Dana Show podcast. Unleash the power of knowledge at your fingertips by following Dana on Apple, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts.
I stand before you a heartbroken man. Part of my purpose has been taken. God gave me a beautiful daughter to father, protect, provide for, and nurture. A man with an evil heart stole her life. He was in this country and in this state illegally. My vision for every senator in this chamber is that you protect citizens from this illegal invasion. Please recognize over a million illegal aliens are in this state and making families nervous. Please recognize Athens-Clarke is a sanctuary city, and this policy and the lack of action led to the murder of my daughter. There are a few of you in this chamber that are standing up and working on a solution to protect us. For that, my family is thankful. Lakin is thankful. Governor Kemp, please declare an invasion to detain and deport criminal illegals so we can prevent future families from those tragedies.
That's Lakin Riley's father, who's asking for the Georgia governor to declare this to be an invasion. His daughter was just brutally murdered by an individual who entered the country illegally and had already was a violent offender and kept being a violent offender. It's shocking how just magically crossing the Rio doesn't change that. Welcome back to the program. Dana Lash here with you at the bottom of this second hour. It's heartbreaking. I mean, and there are so many families that have this, these stories. And for all of the talk from Democrats, you know, the people who are most affected are, you know, Hispanic Americans. The people who are most affected are the people that Democrats oddly want to pretend don't exist. You know, people who come and become Americans and they go through the whole process, etc. I mean, I think it's one of the reasons why they are really performing poorly polling wise in so many states. I was just reading this piece where CNN had even been measuring, for instance, the approval rating for Biden from Hispanics. And it's apparently the worst that CNN's ever measured. And that's just one measure of this. And that's how Democrats see everything. They're struggling. They can't. It's because people who are, you know, Latino and Hispanic communities, they are the most affected by the illegal activity at the border. I mean, they're targeted. I've heard so many stories of border families and then people who, you know, come into the United States and they're the most affected demo. And this administration, they see this administration is making it all the worse. It's just horrible. I feel so bad for the Riley family because this was preventable if we respected who was coming into our country and we respected our borders enough. We respected our sovereignty. We respected, you know, the law and order that we claim that we want and we claim to uphold. And she is a sacrifice at the altar of political correctness as it pertains to the border. And people see this. And there are Hispanic families that have these stories. And there was a family that was in Houston that was targeted. Illegal immigrants ended up murdering a member of their family. What do you think what signal does that send about the American dream to people who want to come to the United States? And then they come to the United States and my gosh, they are as unprotected here from some of these criminal elements that are targeting them after they come across the border as they are in their countries of origin. What are you selling people with the American dream? Because law and order is part of that. Speaking of law and order, there's an update on this Missouri teen. So they said that the girl, her name, Kaylee Gain, who was pictured in a video, the 16-year-old, she was attacked by this girl who was bashing her head into the pavement, even well after Kaylee Gain had passed out. And you could see she was not resisting. Her arms were just sort of flapping. And this girl continued to attack her, even really well seeing that she was out of it, not even responding anymore. Kaylee Gain is in the hospital. She has a skull fracture. She had brain bleeding, all of this stuff. And the family of the girl charged with violently assaulting her, I think we talked to the Attorney General, Andrew Bailey, about this last week. I think it's attempted murder, personally. He thinks that, I mean, he's of a similar thought. And she's still in a life-threatening condition, Kaylee Gaines, a 16-year-old who was attacked. So the family of the attacker who was charged, they said, no, she was just defending herself during this fight. And her aunt said, no, she's an honor roll student at Hazelwood East, and she was defending herself. That's a really weird thing to say, especially when there are numerous reports of kids and families from this school who were made aware of this attacker, apparently bragging about how she was going to beat this girl up after school. Apparently, she was telling everybody she's going to beat this girl up after school. But so the family, and you want to know why the attacker is the way she is? I don't know. Maybe it's because the family's running defense for her. I don't care what Kaylee Gain did. I don't care if she was a, I don't care what this girl did. These are children, by the way. They're 15 and 16 years old. They're children. I don't care if one girl was promiscuous and one wasn't, if both were, if one's an honor roll student. I don't care what it is. At one point, that girl stops fighting back, and the attacker wasn't defending herself. The attacker began attacking the moment she got the girl to the ground. And then she kept doing it even after it was shown on video that Gain could not even fight back. She was just out of it. She couldn't defend herself. Her arms were limp. And the girl had her in a full mount, grabbed her head with both hands, and just slammed it like you're trying to crack a coconut on the concrete. Slammed her head into the ground repeatedly over and over and over and over and over again. I think she would have kept going until someone pushed her off. Juan's showing some of the video. We're not showing the whole thing because right after another girl knocks the attacker off, Kaylee Gain is on the ground. She's twitching and convulsing, and it's really hard to watch. So we're not going to show that part because her arm contorts up into a very odd posture, and she starts twitching and contorting. And it's, like I said, very difficult to watch. But at that point, you know that this girl's not fighting back, and you're just doing it at that point. That's not defense. That's like, think about it in terms of firearm law for a moment. If someone trespasses, someone kicks the door down, breaks into your home, and you defend yourself and your family and you open fire. The moment that person turns and flees, if you pursue, you become the antagonist in the eyes of the law. I know it's wild, but the moment they turn and flee, if you pursue, you are the antagonist in the eyes of the law. I've taken, I don't know how many defensive courses that include sitting in a classroom and listening to, Second Amendment attorneys and self-defense attorneys talk. You become the aggressor in that situation, and you will essentially do yourself in. It won't become a self-defense issue anymore. It will become you pursued this person. And because there was a story of a guy who he had a knock on his door, and I think it was a young man who knocked on the guy's door. The guy answered with a shotgun, and the guy had the young man had the wrong house. He wasn't there to do anything malicious. For whatever reason, the man who opened the door was making the argument that he was fearing for his own safety and his life, the life of his family. And he chased the younger guy off, but pursued the younger guy and ended up shooting him in the back. That guy went, I think he got convicted. I can't remember. It was manslaughter. I can't remember what the charge was, but that dude ended up being convicted. You can't, the moment you are in the position of power and the other person is no longer presenting that aggressive threat, that's not self-defense anymore. This chick was not defending herself when she was in full mount. She was attacking this chick. And so the family is saying, no, we want the judge to have compassion. I'm trying to figure out compassion for what? Where was the compassion for the girl who's never going to be the same again? Never going to be the same again, ever. And so the family said, no, she's an honor roll student. She was harassed and bullied. I know honor roll students who were jerks. What does that have to do with anything? And they said that the family's been defending her and saying that she basically, like, she had the right to do this. They said, no. She was defending herself from harassment and bullying. And then there was a claim that was made that Kaylee Gain, who literally is much smaller, by the way, and the way that that girl threw her first punch, and Kaylee Gain in the video, it looks like she threw the first punch, but that doesn't matter. You don't bash somebody's head on the pavement when they're already out. And that's at that point, you shouldn't need to do a step-by-step Zapruder level explanation of why that's indefensible. That's just stupid. You either get it or you're a moron. At that point, it's not self-defense. I don't care what happened before then. I don't care. At that point, that girl was the attacker and she has to pay the piper for it. The second thing is that all these adults and even the school officials, I don't care that this wasn't on school grounds. This was fostered by the school's policies. This school apparently is notorious for fights and bullying and harassment and all kinds of stuff, meaning that this school run by adults, grown people, cannot properly keep their students in check. the family of Gain, apparently, their parents, I read another piece where it was reported that their parents had even contacted the school prior to this attack, saying that this girl had been talking about how she was going to beat up Gain, etc. And the school didn't do anything. I don't care who started as the aggressor. Again, at some point, the school has culpability and all these parents have culpability as well. Because that's just inexcusable. I mean, this girl was in a, thank heavens, there was another girl there. I don't know whose side that girl was on. She just bum rushed the attacker and knocked her off Gain because I think she realized this girl's going to die. And I guarantee you, if she hadn't been stopped, that attacker would have killed that girl. That girl was just about dead already. That attacker would have killed her right there in the street. Right there in the street. And I'm watching this, and it looked to me like the girl who attacked Gain could fight. She knew how to fight. It looked like she'd been in some dust-ups before. Gain looked like she had never been in a fight before in her life. I mean, there's just certain things that you know and certain things that you don't. And that girl who was the attacker looked like she had been in some fights before. The video doesn't lie. To me, I don't think that this is, unless I see evidence that this is a racially motivated thing, I don't think it's a racially motivated thing. And especially, you know, in St. Louis, there are certain school districts. Kane went to one. He was in a school district where I guess you could call him a white Hispanic. He was the minority in his school. And it's not as played up all in some districts in some parts of the country as it is played up in California, New York, and elsewhere. I don't, unless I see evidence that it was a racially motivated thing, I don't think it was. I think this was kids that are high on their own farts, and I think that they were undisciplined, and that the school, the adults that were around them all let them down. Nobody had policed this. Apparently, they had a long-running beef that was well-known to both adults and kids, and nobody did anything, and they allowed it to get to this point. That's inexcusable. Absolutely inexcusable. We have Florida Man on the way, and as we get moving, our partners.
Are you capable? Are you ready to step into the role and do whatever the country would need?
Absolutely ready. But thank God our president is in good shape, in good health, and is ready to lead in our second term.
Is he, though? He's ready to lead in the second term. Do you really feel confident about her claim there? Welcome back. That's the VP, Kamala Harris. Dana Lash here with you. Top of the second hour, you can listen coast to coast. You can stream the program, Channel 347 DirecTV as well. You can also find us YouTube, Facebook, Substack, chapter and verse, the newsletter. No one believes that. No one believes that. You know, he apparently has no work before 10 a.m. He goes for a 45-minute workout when he wakes up. I was looking at a couple of different pieces on this. There's one over at Politico, there's one at Daily Mail. What?
I was told that Biden does more in an hour than most of us do all day.
Well, he does a 45-minute workout when he gets up. Let me see if you do more in your day, Kane.
All right. Hang on, right?
So, you know, he gets out of bed, not usually before 10.
Ooh.
45-minute workout, physical therapist. He focuses on balance exercises, reportedly.
Yeah, I just walk.
Yeah, yeah. He, usually gets there after, he usually gets to his Oval Office desk after 10, and he leaves before 7. Most of his activities, his public events are scheduled between 10 and 4, because they say that's when he's at his sharpest.
He probably has dinner right after.
Yeah. They usually they call, he's late to everything and they call it Biden time. Follow-up questions are limited. Like when he got the Egyptian leader's name wrong. They were worried about him tripping. So, like, you know, he does all that stuff. If he has to go anywhere, he, I mean, it already sounds like he's got a pretty lax day, I got to say, right?
Yeah.
You know, 1 hour, as you said, and more than 1 hour. Secret Service agents put an agent now on the stairs, an extra agent at the bottom, apparently. And he got new black sneakers, but he apparently stumbled up the stairs again yesterday because he didn't have his black sneakers on. But he apparently got special sneakers that he, I guess he's supposed to wear when he goes up the stairs. So, yeah, 7-8, his cat wakes him up.
What?
His 4-year-old American short-haired tabby called Willow. An insider, White House insider, says the cat wakes him up. Jill Biden is already out doing a spin class.
Cat does not wake him up.
That's what they say.
It's a lie.
Yeah.
The cat doesn't care.
Biden gets at least 8 or 9 hours of sleep. Obama apparently slept 5 to 7. Trump usually slept 5 to 6. And they said George W. was the weirdo because he would wake up at like 5 in the morning and he would read newspapers and have coffee and start his day at like 6. That's not weird. It's not totally weird. But he does his mobility workout with his physical trainer and he's not in the office, but you know, he's definitely not in his office before 10. So I don't know. He doesn't. It sounds like his, I mean, because he was just back at his beach house last weekend, right? But he left. He didn't come back till like Tuesday, something to that effect.
Do we have any video of him doing a workout, like a 45-minute?
No, but I have a million photos of him sitting on his beach chair, and I also have a million photos of Secret Service standing in the full sun on the beach, and I feel bad for them. I'm like, they can't be under an umbrella. No, they're at least in short sleeve shirts.
Oh, that's good.
Button up short sleeve shirts. But, you know, that's just, I feel bad for them. But, yeah, he's got note cards for his whole day. Everything. He's just, I don't know, man. It's just weird. He goes to bed before 11. So if he's anywhere after 7, that's late for him.
It's his life mission to make bad decisions. It's time for Florida Man.
So a man from Coral Springs faces charges of threatening a public servant following his demand for Coral Springs police officers to meet him in the station's parking lot where he loudly serenaded them with NWA song, Blank the Police. Yeah, Coral Springs police, they responded to a call from dispatch. It said the man, Daryl Medlock of Margate, was telling officers, meet him outside, how about that, and playing Blank the Police. According to the report, they were there. They arrived in the lot, and Medlock was positioned inside of his vehicle, and he was playing serenading them with that very loud track. And they said his car was also, to add insult to injury, his car was illegally parked in a handicapped spot. They said he was aggressive, and he charged at one officer yelling MF-er, and the officer drew taser in self-defense. Another officer intervened quickly. They detained him before he could reach the officer and put him in Broward County Jail. Well, that is one way to get yourself arrested. This woman cannot stop starting fires. This is Fort Myers. Police arrested this naked woman because she set a fire at a church, and then she was at a church after they detained her, naked, setting a fire in a church. She somehow managed to set off another small fire in the car's door panel. This is where it gets interesting, because she had been searched. I know you were thinking that. Yes, they had searched her. Remember, she is a nude woman. Okay. In fact, there's an officer that it looks like they put a bulletproof vest over her. She was naked. Remember when they got her from the church, setting the fires, they have her in the back of the patrol vehicle. And she had been searched, but police say that she may have hidden a lighter somewhere that officers would not find it. So you can go ahead and use your imagination as to where that would be, you know, for the naked Florida woman. Just saying. I mentioned this, but we didn't get a lot of time with it yesterday. This man, can you imagine, like, you're doing, you know, it's about that time, you know, you're doing your gardening, you're, you know, you're getting your garden ready for spring. And then imagine that, you find toes sticking out of the ground, or what you think look like toes sticking out of the ground. And that's, you know, apparently what happened with this Florida man. I'm trying to pull this story up and it's not wanting to pull up because everything sucks. The guy made the discovery while renovating his home, getting his garden ready. He's a Florida guy. And he says that he saw these like black objects all lined up sticking out of the ground. He told News 4 Jax this. And he goes, and then I realized they were toes sticking out of the ground. So he called 911. The police arrived. They haven't yet confirmed whose remains it was, but that's it. Jacksonville County. That's it. They said that there were 2 feet sticking up out of the ground. They dug up the body. They went to Duval County Medical Examiner's office. Forensic was, looking at the area, trying to get some, you know, figure out what had happened. They still actually haven't figured out who it is or, you know, cause of death or anything, but good heavens. Police said are seeking a man who urinated on and then set fire to a South Florida car wash. And I think that they're using AI to write their headlines because they spelled, this is how it's spelled. This is police seeking, S-E-E-A-K-I-N-G, a man who, W-H-O-E, urinated, they didn't even spell that right, on, set fire to South Florida car wash. They're totally using AI to write this headline. This guy, this was in Florida City, Florida. They are looking for him. $5,000 reward, Miami-Dade Crime Stoppers. He fled the scene on foot, so they're still, that's why they weren't able to catch him. Stay with us. We got another hour on the way. Tell me that you don't know the difference between natural and civil rights without telling me that you don't know the difference between natural and civil rights. Go.
The one thing that unites all of them, because there's many different groups orbiting Trump, but the thing that unites them as Christian nationalists, not Christians, by the way, because Christian nationalists is very different, mm-hmm. is that they believe that our rights as Americans, as all human beings, don't come from any earthly authority. They don't come from Congress. They don't come from the Supreme Court. They come from God.
So tell me you don't understand the difference between natural and civil rights without telling me that you don't understand the difference between natural and civil rights. Oh, my gosh. This is just like basic reading comprehension. If you read the Declaration of Independence and you also read all of the debate minutes as it came to the founders determining what amendments and how they were going to structure the Constitution of the United States, there's one thing that they all agreed on. And it did not matter the doctrine through which you approached this. It just mattered that you recognize the activity and the guiding hand of the divine into the creation of the Republic, or how they were inspired to acknowledge the presence of the divine in everyday life, which is why you have what's considered, you know, our free speech and the free practice of religion and the right to bear arms, et cetera, et cetera. The difference between natural and civil rights is that natural rights are rights that you have by way of being an American, whether you are born here in the United States or in a territory like on a military base, or if you are you become a citizen of the United States. They are rights that are that you immediately assume that you did not ask for, that you did not have to work for, that you did not vote for, that were not created in a courtroom by humans specifically for you. That is what a natural right is. And that is what the founders were alluding to when they said that we have been gifted by, endowed by our creator with unalienable rights. That is exactly what they're talking about. It is the very definition of a natural right. Civil rights are rights created by men and women in courtrooms to apply to other men and women. Civil rights are rights created by men given to other men. They are not rights at all. Rather, they are privileges that have been decided by the state and given to the citizens of the state. That's it. That's the difference. And I think that this is an absolute bastardization, not only of the meaning of natural rights and the difference between natural and civil rights, but it shows a really embarrassing ignorance just in the understanding of the origin of our entire republic. And what's more, and I've seen this in the thread of this Matt Wolkin put out, I'm going to actually retweet it here in a moment, has this thread that people have filled there, all of these videos like Joe Biden and John F. Kennedy, and I even think Barack Obama, and there was a even Al Gore had given a speech where they're talking about natural rights. Like, for instance, listen to Joe Biden. This was back in 1987. I was in elementary school. 1987, where I guess that this MSNBC talking head would take the exact same objection to this. Listen.
I believe all Americans are born with certain inalienable rights. As a child of God, I believe my rights are not derived from the Constitution. My rights are not derived from any government. My rights are not derived from any majority. My rights are because I exist.
Now see,
I have certain rights.
These people, like this woman on MSNBC, they're trying to ugly up the idea that you have rights that are untouchable by other men. Like, and that's the thing. To destroy belief in God in this country, and communists' biggest enemy is God. Karl Marx's biggest enemy was God. Because if you have these rights that are enshrined in the jurisdiction of the divine, no man can touch them. No man can pervert them. No man can counterfeit them. No man can corrupt them. And that's the entire goal, to very slowly whittle away the belief in the God who endowed these people with these rights so that the jurisdiction can dissipate and those rights can be moved under the jurisdiction of man, and then they can be infringed upon. Actually, they'll convince you that it's not an infringement because it never was to begin with. That's what they'll convince you of. So this whole Christian nationalist term, this is an ignorant phrase, ignorant phrase used by even more ignorant people. And it's either done because they're genuinely and innocently stupid, which I still believe in a culpability in this era of information, or they're just malicious. And I think it's a bit of both.
Dana Show.
American jurisprudence is under attack. It's under attack. Every word is losing meaning. We have a legal system now that doesn't even want to identify or define what a woman is. If you can't take the time to learn about the issue that you want to regulate or ban or whatever, then why should the rest of us take any time at all to take you seriously or to give your opinion air?
The Dana Show.
I agree with you. Under current law, some of the wealthiest Americans pay very little tax because they receive their income as capital gains, and those capital gains aren't taxed until realized and may escape income taxation entirely at death. So the president's budget would impose a minimum tax of 25% on total income, inclusive of unrealized capital gains.
That is absolute straight-up communism. Holy cow. Unrealized gains, taxing money that hasn't actually turned into money yet, taxing money you don't have, that you haven't made yet. Asinine. Taxation is theft. We threw tea in the harbor for less, folks. Welcome back to the program, top of this third hour. Dana Lash with you. Yeah, this budget, by the way, what she's explaining here in that soundbite, Janet Yellen, is, it's a $1.2 trillion budget bill. And interestingly enough, in this bill, it's bad. I mean, it's just bad policy. It's bad. It's just bad. It's bad policy. They're spending money on things like not really for, you know, really, there's not really a lot of border enforcement. I mean, you're looking at the spending. The caps on spending is just obliterated. This is the second half of this omnibus, by the way, was released. And you're funding FBI headquarters. It gives money to the World Health Organization. There's earmarks in this for like Planned Parenthood and stuff. They just, what is it, 8,000 pages? It's out last night. And they're supposed to start initial votes for it today. I mean, in this bill, there is apparently a $400,000 earmark for an organization that gives 13-year-olds binding and tucking clothing without parental permission. That's a real thing that's included in this bill. This so-called other half of the omnibus. I'm looking at some of this. Department of Health and Human Services. The tucking stuff. There's a lot. There's a lot of wokery in here. This is not a good bill. And it lists one of the called Briar Patch is one of the groups, and Briar Patch literally says that their mission is to. Teens Like Us program. And, you know, if you're looking for things of that nature, you're looking for clothing to help facilitate, you know, transition, all this other stuff, then that's what they do. That's part of what they do. This is just wild to see where some of this money is going. And with, you're looking also, it's raising... I mean, it's just as bad. It's just blowing apart any kind of austerity related to the budget, which we should have. I mean, this was bad. And they also in this bill, and Chip Roy noted this, House Republicans prohibited the Treasury from creating a central bank digital currency. That provision, he says, was not included in this. It's bad. I mean, we're looking at, this is $500 million. This is for operation, maintenance, defense. For government of Jordan, support armed services of Jordan to enhance security along Jordan's borders. We're literally paying to help. And this is actually, this was section 8126. We're literally giving money to Jordan for Jordan's borders. We're not spending anything on our borders. We're increasing the beds at the processing centers, and we're going to be adding more staffers to probably process people because there's nothing in there for the force multiplier of a physical wall. There's also nothing in there for any kind of actual enforcement. I said this first hour. I don't care how much money they pretend that they're going to give to the border, even if it's a pittance in this. I don't care how much money they want to pretend that they're going to give. it's meaningless when you are barred from deportation. It is meaningless when you're barred from even detaining for, you know, past X amount of hours. At that point, all you're doing is spending money on faster facilitation of illegal entrance through these processing centers. That's literally all you're spending money on. You're not spending money on any kind of deterrence, any kind of force multipliers. There's no money in this for a wall. There's no money in this at all whatsoever with regard to deportation. None of it. None of it. So this is bad. It's just that it's not a good bill. This is bad. This is so bad. And like I said, they've been reading it all morning. They've had to go through this. Lawmakers did, because it was dropped on them last night. What a mess. What a mess. Like, we got to avert a shutdown. We have to, you know, we got to end this budget fight, a $1.2 trillion plan. They're going to keep kicking this down the road. I told you this fight was going to come up again because they passed the CR last time. Just a mess, an absolute mess. So the Republicans should not be supporting this at all whatsoever. It's just a disaster. They also have in here, goodness, some of this other spending, divesting in policing. What does that sound like to you? Divesting in policing. What does that sound like? I mean, I know what it sounds like to me. What does it sound like to you? It sounds like defunding the police. That's what it sounds like. It sounds like defunding the police. And this is what's in this budget. So there's nothing good in here. And I'm looking over some notes of it because I've been going through it when I can here. One of the other, they're being accused of wanting to to raise the retirement age and cut Social Security as well. Social Security is a scam, and I think it's money forcibly it's stolen from people. The government says it's going to take care of you with it, but that's not what it is. It's a giant Ponzi scheme. Social Security they've been saying that this is going to be insolvent, that the insolvency is coming up. I mean, they've been warning us about this for 20 years. It's what lawmakers. They protect it because they use it to pay for other stuff. And then they get money from the younger generations to fill that and give it to the older generations who paid in. It's your money. Government acts like it's theirs. They act like all your money is theirs. It's there. It's your money. It's not there. So it's a Ponzi scheme. They keep having to take from the next generation to make up for what they took from the previous generation. And Republicans are terrified to talk about privatization of Social Security. I think everybody should get what they put into it. I think the government should refund everybody's Social Security dollars. Give them all back. Isn't it asinine they were able to give out checks for PPP when they shut down, under a Republican administration, no less, they shut down the largest economy in the world, and then they were able to give out checks to everyone? So you should be able to really give out, make sure that people are refunded the money that they paid in with Social Security. You would have been able to get so much more had you left it with a bank instead of the government. But Republicans are afraid to say this because Democrats then accuse them of wanting to cut Social Security, but they don't actually tell you anything else about it. They don't say anything else about it. So this budget's bad. It's bad. No surprise there. They're probably, I don't know. I mean, it seems like Mike Johnson wants to pass it. He's done fighting. Mike Johnson is done fighting, and he's saying, you know, it's not the best thing, but, you know, we're happy with at least this much. There's not a lot in there to be happy about. I mean, you got to listen to people like Chip Roy and Thomas Massie who've been raging about this, and it's not just them. There are a lot of senators that are upset with this as well. Some of the other things I want to make sure that we are hitting on with this. I want to make sure we touch on this stuff. Resolution that Anthony Blinken through the UN submitted through the Security Council, I'm pulling this up, because they're demanding a ceasefire with a hostage release, which is never going to happen. So they said he submitted a draft to the draft UN resolution calling for immediate ceasefire in Gaza. He's Secretary of State. He announced the push for peace early this morning. And it submitted this resolution to the UN Security Council demanding immediate ceasefire linked to the release of hostages, which isn't going to happen because it's worked well for Hamas. Hamas is going to keep these hostages. They have leverage. And the ceasefire proposal. It was presented to mediators. They would see the release of Israeli hostages in exchange. This is what Hamas presented. They presented a Gaza ceasefire proposal. Theirs would release Israeli hostages in exchange for releasing the terrorists that they took that were trying to kill Israelis and that are serving life sentences. So the people that were that had violated previous ceasefires that are jailed, Hamas demands you release the terrorists for the innocents, including babies. You know, so that they can go back out and do it all over again. I don't think that you can negotiate with Hamas. Hamas has to be wiped off the planet. Here's the thing. This is what everyone's very, this is why you have the left so nervous and why everybody walks on eggshells. There was new polling out. This is via Marina Medvin. New polling out from this month, March. It was done by Gazans, and they were surveying people living in Gaza and the West Bank. Both groups, so you have those who live in Gaza and those who live in the West Bank, both groups overwhelmingly supported the October 7th massacres and kidnappings, even though it caused retaliation and defense in Gaza. 71% of people living in Gaza and 71% of those in the West Bank that support Hamas, they support the massacre. And the survey says that the support for Hamas's decision to launch the October 7th offensive remains unchanged. The survey notes that a vast majority of the people, 71%, compared to 72% in December of last year, say it was correct. And they said that the perception about the decision, there's only any drop there is in West Bank, but it's only by a few points. And in Gaza, it's by like 1 point more. And it was conducted by Gazans. I don't use the word Palestinian because it's a, just like I don't call a man a woman because he tucks, I'm not going to also like make up an entirely, I'm not going to have my language forced and make believe that this entity has existed when there's nothing in antiquity that ever supports its existence. This kind of, this really complicates the whole, well, Gazans are not Hamas argument. Go back to when all of these, some of the few hostages that were freed, remember when they were saying that they were being kept in civilian homes? There was this idea that they were being kept in these like tunnels, these Hamas tunnels. That was apparently just the path to where they were being kept. This is why Hamas cannot exist. That's why they can't exist. We have more on the way. We got headlines coming up as we roll. Committing to a healthier diet this year seemed like a straightforward resolution, but actually doing it, that's way more challenging. Better nutrition is a key to health and longevity. So this year, get into a new healthy habit with Field of Greens. Field of Greens is nutrition the way nature intended it. Each superfruit and vegetable in Field of Greens was doctor selected to support vital organs such as the heart, lungs, and kidneys, as well as promoting a healthy metabolism for sustaining energy and weight management. Field of Greens is an organic superfood rich in antioxidants, fiber, and prebiotics formulated to enhance overall well-being. People taking Field of Greens have noticed more energy throughout the day, healthier looking skin, and improved digestion. You'll notice better health or your money back. If you resolve to get healthier in 24, it starts with Field of Greens. Visit fieldofgreens.com and use promo code Dana to get 15% off your first order and free rush shipping. That's promo code Dana at fieldofgreens.com.
And now, all of the news you would probably miss. It's time for Dana's Quick Five.
So this is a headline I never thought I would see. This is in Houston. They're calling them the Little Rascals Trio. Three kids, ages 11, 12, and 16, were arrested because they robbed a Wells Fargo. They're looking for them. They don't know where these kids are. They say they're called the Little Rascals. They have no idea where these kids are, but they robbed a Wells Fargo bank. And I don't really have any words. That's kind of wild. The FBI's Houston office said they're looking for them. They posted an image of them on X. They were all wearing hoodies inside the lobby. And a message left with the FBI said that they were seeking additional information, but it wasn't immediately returned. That's probably it. They said that they're not releasing a lot of information about them because, you know, they're young. They're minors. And I just 11, 12, and 16. An 11-year-old, a 12-year-old, a 16-year-old robbing a bank. This is the problem with youth today. What is happening with our teens? What's happening with our kids? This is just, I mean, every day we get these stories. A Montana man has used animal tissue and testicles to breed giant sheep for sale. I'm trying to pull this up. You'll have to forgive me because I'm having major technical difficulties right now with all of my stuff. And they said that they're breeding giant sheep, blah, blah, blah. I'm not able to pull this up. I apologize. This is just, we're about to have a major meltdown of equipment here in the studio. This story, we'll go to this metal detectorist stumbling on a 650-year-old artifact. It's kind of wild that we can I'm not even able to actually pull this up either, Steve. I'm not able to pull this up. What we're going to do is we're going to go ahead and go to break right now because I'm literally about to have a meltdown with our whole system. So we're going to do that real quick. When we come back, we're going to reset everything. Apologies. Get that up in working order. But we have a lot more of the Dana Show coming up here next. Stick with us.
Elevate your commute, workouts, or downtime with the Dana Show podcast. Unleash the power of knowledge at your fingertips by following Dana on Apple, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts.
I'm here as an athlete giving you my story and what I've seen in my
field. On August 27th of 2020, you tweeted this, quote, I'm going to quote, "Police are paid with taxpayer dollars. If they are not answerable to us, we can demand new service," and that's what this is. "Abolish the police in favor of that new service," end quote. You think we ought to abolish the police, do you?
Again, not the topic I'm here to talk about today.
I know, but you tweeted it. Do you think we ought to abolish the police?
That's not what I'm here to talk about.
Should we do that before or after we get rid of fossil fuels?
I'm not going to address that.
That's... Yeah, you don't want to address it. Okay. Let me ask you about one more of your tweets. On August 26, 2020, you tweeted, there's a picture. I'm not going to describe the picture, but you said, quote, your words, not mine. It's on your Twitter feed. Quote, "This is what systemic racism looks like. The Los Angeles Police Department is literally policing only the Black Lives Matter side," end quote.
So this skier, this is a skier. This is a climate change hearing. In fact, what is it called? It's the nature of climate costs. It's a hearing about the nature of climate costs. And that was Louisiana Senator John Kennedy who was questioning this cross-country Olympian skier, this Gus Schumacher dude, about what he was posting on social media. Now, that might seem silly to you, but there's a reason why. First, welcome back. Dana Lash with you, bottom of this third hour. The reason why he was asking about posts related to defunding the police and everything else is because this Schumacher dude was brought in to testify in this hearing to advise the government, essentially, on climate. And Kennedy was pointing out, are you really a credible person to listen to? Because here's what you've said about defunding the police. Here's what you've said in the aftermath of the George Floyd death. Here's what you've said, you know, on all of these other issues. That all ties in to this guy's credibility. And he's there because he's supposed to be a credible witness, right? He's supposed to be somebody credible to talk about the nature of climate costs. That's why he's there. When they bring these witnesses on, and as Kennedy noted, when they bring these witnesses up, and these witnesses are trying to advise members of Congress based on what they do and what they know, their credibility, it is important to know, well, what do you exactly believe? What is it that you believe? Because, like, he literally asked that, he asked him, he goes, you know, the war on drugs, he says, he noted that Schumacher had retweeted that the war on drugs was intentionally created to incarcerate Black people en masse. That's what he had said on a couple of years ago on X. And Kennedy goes, well, who intentionally created this? Schumacher was like, oh, I don't recall typing. I don't recall this. Or I'm not going to get into this. I mean, and Kennedy goes, well, even if it's a retweet, I mean, you're kind of indicating your support here, right? And Schumacher's like, well, yeah, maybe, but I'm not here for that. Yeah, but that's the thing, though. You are here because of who you are, and you've had no problem lending your name to all of these other belief sets. How is this any less crazier than the other crazy crap that you've put your name to? That's the whole point of him asking this question. Good grief. Just because people have opinions sometimes doesn't mean that the world is entitled to entertain them. I wanted to touch on this story as well, this issue of this 82-year-old woman. So it's not just Planet Fitness. Daily Wire had this story of an 82-year-old woman who is demanding, she was asking for access to a local YMCA pool. She was banned from the facility after speaking out against a guy using the women's locker room. And her name is Julie Jamin. She's now being represented by the Center for American Liberty. Harmeet Dillon is actually her attorney. And she was a member of the YMCA. And there was a man she found, you know, a man in the woman's locker room. And she was concerned about that. So she, you know, raised concern with the management. And she was promptly banned. She's been in this town of Port Townsend for, 40 years? And they said that she's regularly used the Mountain View swimming pool for recreational and therapeutic purposes. In 2022, the YMCA banned her because she spoke out expressing her concern about a man in the woman's locker room. She went in to change and shower. There were no signs warning people that the locker rooms were open to members of the opposite sex. In fact, she noted, and apparently they have, like, you know, the photos there. I guess they're still there. The signs on the door indicated that they were sex segregated. And she said when she was in the shower, she heard a male voice inside the locker room. And she peeked out of the shower curtain to see who was there. And it was a male and who was watching two little girls use the toilet. And she was so startled. She was trying to figure out what this could, because the man apparently didn't look like he was with the girls, and apparently wasn't. And he was in a female swimsuit, which I'm sure you can see how well that went. And she asked him if he had a male copulatory organ, and he responded, "None of your business." And then a YMCA staff member, they said within seconds, entered the shower area and began berating the elderly woman. Her name is Rowan DeLuna. She was the YMCA staff member who entered the area and began berating her in front of, you know, other people in the locker room. And she was saying, "You don't know that that person's transgender and that person's an employee of the YMCA and he can use whatever, you know, with his gender identity that he wants to." And she called, you know, she told the elderly woman, she said that she was a discriminatory. And then right there, she banned her for life and told her she could no longer set foot inside the facility. And she said, "You better leave or we're going to call the police." And so Jamin told DeLuna, "Okay, yes, please do, because I want to know why this individual is dealing with a 4- and 6-year-old trying to use the toilet that are not his kids." And the YMCA called 911 because they're absolute just drama queens. And they demanded that the police escort the elderly woman from the premises because the elderly woman, they said, she was refusing to leave, none of which was true. The elderly woman actually wanted the police to figure out why this man, a full-grown man who looked like a man and had a male copulatory organ and everything, was in a female swimsuit and watching little girls in the bathroom. She thought that she was witnessing a crime in progress. And they lied about her and said that she was belligerent and harassing people, which she wasn't. And so she left the pool and she went right to the police station, which actually is right by the YMCA. And she was going to file a complaint with the man's actions towards the girls in the women's locker room, right? I mean, that's what anybody would do if they think they're seeing a crime. And then when the police followed up, it wasn't to look at her complaint. It was to investigate YMCA's complaint. And that's when Jamin, the elderly woman, learned of the false accusations that YMCA, the staff, had said about her to police. So she immediately contacted the CEO of the YMCA to report the incident. And she said, "No, that was a transgender man. He's a member there. And he's a man who wants to be a woman. And, you know, that's you should have," she told Jamin, "you should have been aware of the locker room policy because there were pride flags hanging up." What does the pride flag have to do with the trans stuff? And they said they were standing by the man and that she was still banned. So they said later on, she went to the sidewalk outside the facility to voice her opinion. She protested, basically. And they began, I mean, they just waged a campaign of false accusations on this woman. And so now she's got this case, she's got this lawsuit, and I hope she wins because this is insane. They had a small group of citizens that support the elderly woman. They had a protest in a park near the YMCA, all of this stuff. This is the craziest story. I would have absolutely done the same thing. And the it amazes me that the police is, I mean, that you're talking about an 80-year-old woman who is watching a younger grown man watch two girls, 4 and 6 years old, use the restroom. Who wouldn't say, hey, you're in the women's locker room and you have Frankenbeans and you're wearing a women's swimsuit. That's a little weird. Who wouldn't have said anything? Oh, this is what I'm talking about, how dangerous this is. The piece that I wrote about the woman who was banned from Planet Fitness. Women are told to ignore their instincts. They're told to ignore the inner voice that is there as to raise an alarm over anything that doesn't look right, anything that could compromise your safety or the safety of someone near you. Women have been told, we've been told for our entire lives to listen to that voice, and now women are being proactively shamed for it. They're being harassed for it. It is being weaponized and used against women. You are being socially conditioned to ignore warning signs, particularly women. That is the absolute opposite of female empowerment. There is a movement underway, and this is what trans activism does, to socially condition women to be more really more unassuming when it comes to predatory behavior, to be more susceptible to predation. It is a social conditioning all about making women more susceptible to predation. Usually it's Occam's razor. She's used this pool for 40 years. And so now Harmeet Dhillon, she's going to be on with us next week, is saying that this ban has to be reversed. The YMCA has to offer apology. The city has to offer apology. And it is amazing. The media, if this was in any other situation, the media would be all about rah-rah for this woman. And they're not, because the media is garbage. Speaking of the media, have you seen them? The weeping and gnashing of teeth as it relates to our discussion, my interview with Florida Governor Ron DeSantis just the other day. And he was saying that, well, you know, if these Haitian illegal entrants keep coming up, you know, maybe they'll go to Martha's Vineyard. And he was explaining the caveat for maritime law. If you interdict a vessel with all of these illegal entrants in the water, that's one thing. You can repel it, you know, et cetera. But when people are on land, that same law that the federal government is going back and forth like SB4 with Texas over and Arizona, that same law comes into effect. And so that's why he's like, well, then we'll just send them to Martha's Vineyard. Well, now you have Ariana Presley, who is livid over it. She's, you know, Boston. She's livid over this, a member of the squad. She's saying that making accusations that it's bigoted, etc. I thought that she liked, people coming in from other countries. I thought that, you know, she supported sanctuary policies. Massachusetts isn't a sanctuary state per se, but they have a lot of sanctuary policies. I thought that she welcomed all of that stuff. But I guess she's a bigot, right? Like all of these other faux sanctuary people, they're actually bigots. They want everyone else to handle the work that goes along with being a sanctuary city or a sanctuary state and incur the cost. So they're apoplectic over this. The media has been, oh, can you believe Ron DeSantis said that he would send them to Martha's Vineyard? Why don't you talk about what Martha's Vineyard, you know, people who were celebrating sanctuary, why don't you talk about how they called the National Guard day of? And within 2 days had all of the people that were dropped off the last time sent out to like an army barracks or something. They immediately wanted to get rid of everyone because, see, it's easier to virtue signal with other people's resources. These people don't really believe the stuff that they say. They just want you to live that way, but not them. And he kind of exposed that. Not kind of. DeSantis exposed it. He's trying to make them honest with their sanctuary city policies. We have more on the way. We have Today in Stupidity coming up. Our partners over at
Follow Dana on Apple, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts, because knowledge is your ultimate superpower.
I've spent more time with Xi Jinping, the leader of China, than any other world leader has. And I was with him, traveled 17,000 miles with him when he was vice president, and I was vice president, before he became the leader. And we're in the Tibetan Plateau, and he asked me, he said, can you define America for me? I said, I sure can, one word. And he looked at me, I said, possibilities, possibilities.
So he made up a story about traveling and being in the Tibetan Plateau with Xi Jinping. And he made it up, and they said that he made it up at the time. Even PolitiFact said he made it up. And he still repeats it. He keeps repeating the same weird fake story over and over again. I mean, this is, I don't even think the press really calls him to account for that. But then, heaven forbid, if you bring up the fact that he's untrustworthy because he keeps repeating false stories that have been, that are just egregiously lie. They're just egregious lies, like how his son Bo, well, no, I lost him in Iraq. No, I lost him, you know, here or there. I mean, he makes up stories about how his oldest son passed away. A million different stories about how I think he said the last time, what, Bo passed away, he was, almost made it sound like, oh, yes, it was in combat. It wasn't in combat. Or it was, you know, another, was he, did he have an issue with an illegal immigrant? I mean, the way that Biden talks about this stuff, this is what happens when you use these things and you try to fit and modify them and use them as like some sort of shallow fake outreach. It's just so bad. It's just so bad. We're watching this, the second part of this omnibus. I'm going to be off. I have it's a work trip. It's not like a vacation trip. It is a work trip. I know we got my friend Sergio, and I know we have another great friend of the show who's going to be filling in behind the mic for me tomorrow and Monday, and I'm going to be back behind the mic on Tuesday. May have some stories to tell. We'll see. But I'll keep you updated. It should be very, it'll be a very productive trip. In the meantime, today in stupidity, because it's a long one, Steve.
All right. Representative Al Green, and not the fun Al Green, the weirder Al Green. He tried to rewrite history, but we're all going to have, I'm sure Dana has a little bit to share about the history lesson here. So cut 5-1 if you get a chance.
I wanted to just remind him of something that I'm sure he's acutely aware of. And that is that 14th of May, 1948, Israel declared itself a state. And President Truman, who was the president of the United States at that time, was the first major world power or country to recognize Israel as such. And that has created an imbalance. I'm hoping that we will understand that at that time, the Palestinians did not consent to Israel becoming a state.
That Palestine never existed.
In fact, they were vehemently opposed.
Their consent wasn't required, Al Green.
To have Israel's consent.
You shame the name of the better man because they didn't exist. And Israel is simply affirming its statehood. I mean, history is important. Maybe you should pick up a book. You know, one that, you know, is not like history core, like the progressive history. Folks, that does it for us today. Sign up for the newsletter, Substack, Chapter and Verse. I'll be back with you tomorrow. Have a great weekend. Or actually...